this
land is mine. God gave this land to me. This brave and ancient land to me. And when the morning sun reveals her hills and plains, then I see a land where children can run free. So take my hand and walk this land with me, and walk this lovely land with me. Though when you are by my side, with the help of God, I know I can be strong.
Well, good evening. Welcome to Yada Yah. My name's Craig. We're here with Kirk and Dee. And we're going to continue in what is, in my view, the Song of Dowd, Dowd's Song, the 89th Mizmowr. I think that the 89th Psalm is second only to portions of the Torah, the most important piece of prophecy and literature ever written. You could consider it the cornerstone of the covenant, the cornerstone of Yahweh's family home, which some people refer to as the temple. It is the prophecy that should have destroyed both Judaism and also Christianity before they were born. Mm-hmm. Had Jews and Israel at the time recognized the obvious, since Dowd told them exactly the day that he would arrive in Jerusalem to fulfill Pesach, Matzah, and Bukurim. And since he had written a first-person account of his fulfillment of Passover in the 22nd Psalm or Mizmor, and had written a first-person account of his fulfillment of Matzah in the 88th Mizmor, and had in the first 25 Mizmors explained precisely why he had decided to do this and why Yahowah approved his plan to fulfill each of the seven Moed Mikra. Beyond that, in the both in 2 Samuel 7 and in the 2nd Mizmor and again in the 89th Mizmor, it is clearly stated that Dowd is the Son of God and that he is also the Messiah. So, with all of that information, how was it that those who were forming Judaism at that time, and it was at the point that this all took place, was only one person referring to himself as a rabbi. That happened to be Paul, the author of much of the Christian New Testament. But shortly after that, the rabbis themselves said, "Hey, that's a pretty cool title. It means exalted. We ought to be using that one." They stole it from Paul, I guess. Turnabout's fair play. But for them to have not rebutted Peter and Paul with this Christ BS and that Jesus was the Messiah and the Son of God is almost unthinkable, that they could have allowed this to go on and not brought out the overwhelming evidence against it. And for them to now go another 2,000 years and say nothing, it really is reprehensible. So
yes.
between these various Mizmowr and what we have learned through the prophets elsewhere, we come to recognize something that has not been heralded, really, for 2,500 years. Now, I did have somebody write me, and I think they were trying to be a good steward of accuracy and say, oh, it's not true. You're not the only one that has said these things. There's this fellow that wrote in the 1850s that David was the Messiah and that Christ actually has a slightly different meaning. You can get anything else right. And that's just the beginning of it. I mean, we recognize that there was no Jesus and that the person that whoever he may have been, if he even existed, that the New Testament refers to as Jesus Christ could not have been the Messiah. And we knew that 20 years ago, 15 years ago, 15 to 20 years ago. That's not difficult to figure out. That is exceedingly obvious. Now, the fact that this person could only find one person in the last 200 years that had figured it out is pretty embarrassing. But that's just the tip of the iceberg. The reason that I use Mashyach, the work of Yah, to describe what I referred to as Yosha, since we needed a name, since obviously Jesus didn't exist in the first century.
Right.
But as I say, it's just a touch of what we found.
Right.
It was probably 10 years ago that we began to talk about Dowd as the Son of God. The prophets are very clear.
Yada.
Right.
It wasn't Yada.
It's Dowd that's the Son of God. And so, say 10 to 15 years ago, I began to share something about replacement theology that heretofore no one had discussed, which is that the basis of replacement theology is not what the clerics claim, which is a replacement of Israel by Goyim and the church. That happens to be the consequence of the basis of replacement theology. Replacement theology is when Peter and Paul both claimed that Dowd was dead and buried, and so that every prophecy and every accolade and every title and every achievement ascribed to him, there's a boatload of them, an arkful, if you will, actually applied to their mythical misnomer, Jesus, and that was how this myth grew into the perception that he was somehow the Son of God and a Christ, a Messiah. That wasn't discussed anywhere. And to bring that point home, you really have to understand why Yahowah chose to anoint and how he anointed Dowd three times. Or why Yahowah specifically said that Dowd is his Mashyach. He says it of nobody else. It's also important to understand the basis of what Christos means, which is to be drugged. But if you're really going to pursue this, and you're going to claim that you got it right, then you need to do what no one else in history has done, which is to write a series of books called Questioning Paul. Now, I know that Thomas Jefferson figured out that Paul was a charlatan. Didn't explain why, but he certainly figured it out. And there have been two or three people over time that have criticized Paul in terms of his contradictions against Jesus. I think there's a website, Jesus' Words Only. What a waste. Because you're now comparing the guy that inspired and wrote almost all of the Christian New Testament with his own myths. I mean, that's basically what they're doing. They're saying, well, Jesus said, well, what Jesus is alleged to have said was mostly inspired by Paul. Luke was his propagandist. Mark, it even talks about how Paul told his gang, his posse, you need to go after Mark because I can really use him. And so that's the two of them. And Matthew is nothing but Mark and Luke combined. That's about 90% of it. And 10% of it is plagiarized from the Nebonim that actually had some understanding of what now Dowd said in Hebrew. But even then, we have to wonder, you know, even that credible. Mm-hmm. But that's the basis of it. And then, of course, Paul wrote the 14 books, and the book of Acts is all about him.
Yeah.
No one has ever written a book or a series of books like Questioning Paul to drive this point home, to demonstrate that the Christian New Testament is complete and utter rubbish, a complete fabrication, that you can disprove it by comparing what Paul wrote against what Yahowah said. Not what the myth of Jesus said, against what Yahowah said. No one else has ever done that. No one else has explained the prophecy in Shabat, which specifically calls Paul out by name and calls him the plague of death. No one has gone through the book of Acts and taken Peter's and Paul's first speech and showed that every single statement they made was untrue. No one has taken the time to explain that the Christian New Testament is a complete fabrication in the sense of there are over 300,000 inconsistencies between the first 69 oldest manuscripts and the Textus Receptus and the Nestle Allen. It was only 180 some odd thousand words and 300,000 discrepancies.
That's amazing.
The history of it is fabricated. The things that it claims are impossible. They never took place. It's written in some places like the Sibylline Oracles and other places like the Tales of Odysseus and other places as if we had the reincarnation of Dionysus. But you need to do that if you're going to state a claim that is as bold as what we have stated, which is the one thing no one has done, ever.
Well, it's backed by Yahshua 53.
That Dowd is the Zoroah. Nobody even knows what that word meant until we discovered it. That's the introduction to Yahshua 53 you just mentioned. That Dowd is, therefore, the Passover lamb.
And Yada would figure it out.
That it says that Yada would figure it out.
Yep.
So to recognize that Dowd didn't just get set up to come back and fulfill Yom Kippurim, which we're the first to ascertain, and to be the king of Sukkah, but that Dowd fulfilled each of the first four Mikra, Pesach, Matzah, Bekodim, and Shavua. And we explained precisely how Dowd fulfilled the most complex of them, which was Matzah, by taking our guilt and carrying it with him into Sheol and depositing it there. Because by doing so, there is no testimony that can be brought against us. And if there is no testimony that can be brought against you, you are not guilty. It was genius what God did. And it was genius on behalf of Dowd, David, to recognize that he could give up 2 days, two hellish days, being tortured by the Romans and then spending an entire day in Sheol. But that the benefits of that is that he would be the savior of his people. He would right every wrong they had done. for 2 days. Earn their respect. Earn their love. Become our Savior. Make it possible for him to lead Israel into eternity. These are a lot of things to put together to understand this picture and present this great treasure to Israel, to Yehudim, to the world. And it has been done no place else. Now, the reason that it's important for you to know that it has never been done, and you can look it up, you know, go spend the next 6 months, you won't find it. And the reason it's important is there are hundreds of prophecies addressing what we're doing. Hundreds of them. Sometimes the individual is called the Chota. The longest presentation of this mission is described as a Chota. Interesting term. Secondary branch or sucker? Secondary branch, who's the primary branch? Dowd. You better be able to climb out on that one and know that it's sturdy if you're going to be the Chota. A sucker. What is the sucker? A sucker, particularly as it relates to the olive, is if you take an olive tree that has gotten old and it's lost its vibrancy and it's collapsed, and out of that stump you have new growth. That's a sucker. Out of the old rootstock, which is what it says constantly when Yahweh was describing this individual, out of the old rootstock is where that sucker is going to grow, and it's the original rootstock, that original stump. And it gives the tree new life and makes it possible for it to be productive again.
Yeah.
The oldest prophecies about him are already in the Torah. He's mentioned all throughout the Torah.
Right.
Mentioned all throughout Shamuel. Mentioned all throughout the Mizmowr of Dowd. He is as central to the writing of Yahshayah as is any individual. Because you are not going to be able to prepare God's people for Dowd's return with Yahowah without this individual. And this was, you know, an epiphany to realize that with Yahowah's prophecy, calling him a Bashar, which is a human herald, calling him the Qowl, the voice that calls out, calling him a Malak, messenger, calling him an Edah, witness, calling him the Nakar, which is a observant foreigner. With all of the Chodas we mentioned briefly, calling him Yada, one who knows. That with all of these references, Yahweh put his reputation and that of his prophets on the line. For Yahweh's prophets, there has never been a mistake. Everything they've said has come true. Prophetically, Yahweh refers to Moshe as the greatest of the prophets, but it's because that Moshe was great in many ways, including saving his people. He was one of the two mighty Zoroah. But in terms of just the breadth of prophecy, from beginning to end, no one compares to Yahshayah.
Right.
And Yahshayah covers this over and over again. I mean, it's not only the almost exclusive theme of the 11th chapter. Once you move towards the end of the book and you get to chapters 45 through 60 some odd, it's a driving theme. And so you have this prophet who we have the entire scroll found in the Dead Sea, above the Dead Seas in Qumran, who has gone out of his way to say this individual is going to arise and this will be his job. Yahweh now has put his credibility and his prophet's credibility on the line. What if that guy fails?
Yeah.
What if he says, you know, this is just too much. I want out of this. You know, I didn't sign up for 32 years at 7 days a week at 10 to 14 hours a day. No, a guy's got to have some fun, right? No, I didn't sign up for that. No, what if he fails? What if he turns out to be as big a nincompoop as he was when he started? If he doesn't learn. What if he has an ego and he's not willing to go back and correct his mistakes as he learns along the way? What if he gets too big for his britches and wants to be more than a witness and a herald? I mean, all he is the guy conveying the message. To have all of these prophetic references to him, God put his reputation on the line. He said, this guy's going to come. This is what he's going to do. And then he has his prophets explain the result when he returns with Dowd on Yom Kippurim, which is there's a family reunion. So God can't allow him to fail. He's gone on to say, this is going to happen. And I'm here to tell you, it can't happen without him. Now, that may sound overly bold, but it's just the reality of it. I've finally had to just accept it. Why?
Yeah.
You know, when Moshe, 18th chapter of Dabarim, and Moshe's going back and explaining all of this, and God's talking about it, and they're talking about false prophets and trustworthy prophets and the one that's going to come after him and who he's going to be. And he's speaking of Dowd, and I don't think anybody has figured that out up to this point. But he said, you know, when to be a prophet like me that's going to come from you. When he's discussing all of this, Yahweh says, listen, I tried to talk directly to you. You hated it. You said, I don't want to see his brilliant light. I don't want to hear his voice. I don't do that again. And God said, yeah, you're right. That was overly intimidating. I won't do that again. So what does that mean? That means that God cannot speak directly to his people again until he returns. That's what that means. So what does that mean?
Yes.
That means if God wants to awaken his people, he's got to find someone to communicate through. That means that when the myth of Jesus Christ existed, it was a complete fabrication because they pretend like he's God, and yet God's saying, I'm not going to do that again. So God put himself in a position where he said, he promised, that he would only communicate through men and women to his people. So what happened? Well, according to Yeshayah and the other prophets, Israel went 2,700 years, at least 2,500, probably more accurate because of Malachi, without a single prophet. In fact, when Dowd is speaking to Daniel, and Dowd is Gabriel, God's most courageous and competent man, which is Gabriel, that's what it means, man of God. When he's speaking to him, he's very clear about the fact that he's going to come into Jerusalem and he's going to do all of these things, and that he is the Messiah who is responsible for it. But one of the things he says is that it's going to put an end to prophecy. There'll be no more prophetic revelation. So now God's in another box that he has made for himself. You know, God can put himself into a box. He can restrict himself. He restricted himself when he told Moshe and the children of Israel and the body of 18, I'm not going to do that again. I'm not going to speak directly to the people. I'm going to communicate through the likes of Moshe, which is why he's saying there's somebody that's going to come after him. Well, he's speaking of two different individuals. The first of them happens to be Dowd, that he will communicate through. And there's no one he communicated more through than Dowd. But the second thing is, he said there'd be no more prophets. So after Malachi, no prophets. And it makes sense in this role that he wouldn't want a prophet, because he said, I looked, I couldn't find a single person to communicate my message through. There was no one willing to listen to me. And that's the first prerequisite. You've got to be willing to listen to God. Then you have to be willing to accept what he says. When doing so puts you at odds with essentially everyone. And when God couldn't find any of his people for 2,500 years to communicate through, and when he said, there'll be no more prophets, he put himself in another box. And maybe this is like Houdini. You know, if I put myself in enough boxes, and then I still show that I'm able to get this done, that you'll believe that, you know, I'm for real. And so the next box he put him into is that there would be no prophet, so he has to be a witness. And that's why he never refers to this last Edah as a prophet, a Nabi, but strictly as a Bashar, a herald, a Qowl, a voice, an observant foreigner, a Nakar, a Choder, a secondary branch. So he is now committed to using a Goyim, and a Goyim who's a witness. And this box that he put himself in, this is kind of an illusion as a box, because a prophet would have been less effective than a witness. You know why that is? Let's just pretend that I was, that he said that it was going to be a Yisraelite that was going to convey this message as opposed to a Goyim, and that he had not said anything about no more prophets, and he decided, starting in 2001, 32 years left, that he was going to use a prophet again. Why would that be less effective than a witness? That's correct, not enough time. What a prophet is about, not seeing what tomorrow is going to be. I mean, I can tell you what our tomorrow is going to bring. I said that when we invaded, for example, Afghanistan and Iraq. I said, this is how it's going to turn out. I wasn't a prophet. I just
educated.
Was rational. When we used the Ukraine as a proxy against Russia, I said, this is how it's going to turn out. It's playing out exactly that way. You know, those kinds of things, when you're predicting what's going to happen a year, 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road, that's not a prophet. That's simply being informed and having an understanding of prior events so that you can predict future outcomes. You don't need God's inspiration to do that. To be a prophet, you have to put in writing an eventuality that no human could have predicted at that time. And it has to be explicit and detailed and well-publicized such that when it occurs, everybody said, whoa, that is amazing. But let's say at that point, how many years do you really have? You don't have 32. Maybe you have 20. You have to allow people then to investigate this and come up with the realization, wow, he had prophecies. Now, these would have to be prophecies that were 10 years, 5 to 10 years out, that were still 10 years before his return, that were far enough out to be unknowable, but not so far out that they couldn't be used to validate the testimony, far enough in advance that it would still have some merit to God's people.
Well, in addition, you would have to have, it'd have to be written and available, which it wouldn't necessarily been to the masses. Like all the prophets we know now is because they're written down. They came out either out of the Dead Sea Scrolls or even the Masoretic text. Right. You couldn't do it. You couldn't pull it off. It would be a waste of time. And we don't need any
other problem. The other issue is that since Yah was trying to get Yisrael's attention and say, you know, you have really been irascible. You have been dunderheads. What is it about you? Because there has to be some sense of, oh, we really screwed up. You've got to have a Zechariah 12 moment. Zechariah 12 is where Yahweh says, you know, I'm going to return. I'm going to put my spirit of reconciliation over Jerusalem, and they're going to look up to me and the one that I'm accompanied with that they have pierced, and they're going to mourn for him as you would for an only child, recognizing, holy crap, the Passover lamb all the while was Dowd. How did we screw this up? What an embarrassment it is for us. So if, since that has to happen, there has to be some attrition, the best way to accomplish that is to have a lowly goy read your existing Torah, prophets, and Psalms and figure it out. And then explain it to you using only the Hebrew text of the Torah, prophets, and Psalms that have been available to you 2,500 years to 3,700 years, or 500 years, sorry. That's the ultimate embarrassment. That's the, oh, man, how did we blow this? It was so obvious. And it is that obvious. So that's what God has set up. And the 89th Mizmor just happens to be the bell at the end of the battle that says, okay, dunderheads, I have provided absolute proof that everything he's telling you is true.
Yep.
That's what this is all about. That's why this Mizmor is so important. Why the prophets are so important. It's just astonishing what the Jews have missed in their own language for this many years.
Right.
And part of it is, as I was dealing with one of Yahweh's prophecies today, is that knowing that God told his people, didn't say listen to the goyim. He couldn't, because he painted himself in this box, because it was going to be a goyim that would awaken them in the end and call them home. But he said, don't copy their ways. And so with all of the disgusting Gentile conspiracies that are anti-Jew and their anti-Semitism and their tendency to bludgeon and exterminate Jews, from the Greeks to the Romans to the Ottomans and the Byzantines and the Roman Catholic Church and the Nazis, Jews are not particularly receptive to a goy.
No.
But this is a goy that's telling them, this is your God's name. He's Yahowah. This is your Messiah. His name is Dowd. He's the Son of God. He is your Savior. He fulfilled the Moed Mikre, which you don't even celebrate anymore. But this is what it means to you. And this is how those Moed Mikre serve to provide the benefits of the Be'eth family covenant relationship. And so for that to prevail and be convincing amongst people who have, you know, been pretty stiff-necked and anti-goy, well, that goy is going to have evidence. Well, but I'm looking at just the spines of the book. It's about 4 feet now, just looking at the spines.
Yeah.
And every book is based on exactly the same thing. Here's what Yahweh said. This is what it means. 4 feet of that. This is what Yahweh said. This is what it means. You can't refute that.
Right.
And that's what he needed. He needed irrefutable proof that what he said was true. This is what we're providing. So why did Yahweh offer his choder, his seven spirits? Because there was no time for a mulligan. There was no time for plan B. None. Had to get it right. And he couldn't get it wrong, because he would invalidate himself and every one of the prophets, because he said, this is what I'm going to do and it's going to work. So the only way to make certain that that was going to all happen the way he said it would is to throw seven spirits upon him, so that, you know, when Dowd was, for example, anointed, the spirit of Yahweh came upon him. Well, with the Choder, it's seven. And who knows how many others are creating a no-fly zone for hurricanes over St. Croix.
Yeah. Well.
But nonetheless, I digress. So that's what we're talking about here. It was a joy last week. I think it was the Shabbat after the program the following morning, when Dee sent me the results of what's blossomed in Israel recently.
Yes.
If you go back 2 years, there were Yehudim who had become part of the covenant based upon this mission that Yahweh has empowered called Yada Yahweh, to know Yahweh.
Yeah.
And about two-thirds to three-quarters of those who have done the DNA testing that are part of the covenant family have found out that, oh, son of a gun, I'm Jewish. I'm not, of course, because I was told, it was prophecy that I would be Goy. And sure enough, I am. Not a trace of Jewishness other than I'm probably more Yehud and more Yisrael than anyone claiming to be both with the DNA to prove it. Now,
right.
You go back 2 or 3 years, and we've been doing this at that point, 19 to 20 years, and there were Yehud in the United States and in Great Britain and in New Zealand and in Australia and places that spoke English, but none, not one, in Israel.
Nope.
Well, now there are 1,400 at one level or another of awareness that have identified as living in Israel, of being Jewish in Israel, and having turned to the pages of Yada Yahweh to learn more.
Wow.
And a significant number of those 1,400 have sent us pictures of themselves. That's a handsome lot, by the way. Mostly young, by the way, too. Look, most of the pictures that I saw looked like they were in their late 20s, early 30s. Young men, mostly. You can tell a lot by a picture of somebody. Bright eyes. these are individuals that are taking good care of themselves. These are people that are making a contribution. I don't think I've ever seen faces that just resonated more with me. It was the antithesis of the Haredim. These pictures of young Israeli men in Israel. They were the antithesis of the Haredim. It was so one of the happiest days ever to see this. And, you know, Yahweh was talking about, in the range of 7,000 Yehud. That might not sound like a lot when there's, perhaps 15 billion, or 15 million, I'm sorry, 8 million people, 15 million Yehud to one level or not. But considering the fact that most are already disqualified, all of the ultra-Orthodox are disqualified, most of the Orthodox are disqualified, most of the secular who are all the way to progressives, and who identify through their politics or their sexual orientation or something like that, that defines who they are. Listen, I'm not saying anything against, at this point, homosexuality or bisexuality, anything. It doesn't mean squat to me, and it really doesn't mean anything to Yahweh either. The two statements on what are interpreted to be anti-homosexuality aren't anti-homosexuality. God's got his no-no list sexually, but that no-no list is things that are much more serious: bestiality, incest, pedophilia, rape, those kinds of things.
Right.
If that defines who you are, you're not going to be open to this message. If it's just an aspect of who you are, it probably doesn't make any difference.
Right.
But the progressives, it's probably 30%, maybe more, 35% of Israel are overtly political. And you've got between Orthodox and ultra-Orthodox, probably another 30-35% of Israel that is absurdly religious, they've already disqualified themselves. There's going to be no hope for them. They're not going to show any interest. And so you've already got a much narrower cross-section of people, and some, well, God can reach anybody at any age and invite them into the covenant if he wishes to. But a lot of people who have been really set in their ways are typically not open. That's why I think that so many of the people who sent pictures were young men, rational, thoughtful, open. They're like the definition of a beeb, barley that is still green and growing and not hard, to define the start of that month. And it's for these young men and women that we do this program. It's for these Israelites that we write these books. If you're Goyim and you wish to join us, so long as you're not anti-Israel, so long as you recognize that it's one Torah for all of us, it's one covenant, Bereth for all of us, it's one set of Moed Mikre, invitations to meet with God for all of us, and accept Yahweh's path and his name and his son's commitment to fulfill the Moed Mikre, then you're welcome.
Right.
All right, so we were had just finished the 89th Mizmowr, I think statement 37 was where we were. And it was kind of an interesting spot because in the chapter devoted to this, happens to be presented in a fairly early one of the Coming Home series. It's in volume one of Coming Home. And that's a little bit of a surprise because Coming Home, the commitment of Coming Home is to go through the Moed Mikre, to go through, not the Moed Mikre, I'm sorry, the Psalms, so that we would, through the Mizmowr, be able to chronicle what Dowd has to say about himself. And so the first volume only gets through, in the range of 20 or 21. And so here we have the 89th, but it's because I wasn't patient enough to pace it out, knowing where we were going.
Yeah.
Understandable.
Yeah. So, when you look at God's, the attributes that he's looking for and the men and women that he chooses to work with him, patience is very seldom one of the attributes that he says, oh boy, I'm going to work with that guy or gal because they're patient. So I guess that's okay. Enthusiastic happens to be one of them that he likes. He likes, you gotta like the written word more than the spoken word. You have to be willing to go where the words lead. You have to trust Yahowah. And he prefers people who are passionate by design, and who are courageous, who are not bothered by bucking the crowd. So at long last, we have reached the transition from the benefits that would be provided by Dowd to the consequence of Dowd's people denying him. This is the very thing that drew us to this from 2 Samuel 7, which to my way of thinking, I think 2 Samuel 7 is the pivotal chapter in the entirety of the Tanakh, the Torah, Prophets, and Psalms. It's about what happened 3,000 years give or take a few years from the expulsion from Eden to our return in Eden. And it's a discussion that father and son, Yahowah and Dowd, are having about houses and families and who lives in them and who builds them and how they work together in this regard. It is the preeminent prophecy in the entire story. And it happened to be where I began. There's a word in it, Asher, that attracted us to this place. And in that prophecy, the only way to understand it is to move forward and to cover the 89th Mizmowr so that you understand the consequence that is that happened to Israel as a result of denying Dowd's role as the Son of God and Messiah, as well as the Passover Lamb. So after all of these years of trying, we have finally come to understand this most intriguing of prophecies. Prior to this time, I think I was ill-equipped to process what follows, and that's part of the beauty of all of this. God's not looking for perfect people. His idea is he wants to perfect the imperfect. And, you know, a great example of that is Moshe says, you know, I don't speak very well. I've got a thick tongue. And Yahweh says, yep, you're perfect. We're going to go do this together. Just to prove that I don't care if somebody somehow mispronounces my name when trying to state it correctly. I'm going to pick a guy with a speech impediment to share my name with the world. Just perfect, yeah. With Yahweh. So the reality is that God likes it when we grow in our understanding with him, because it shows the process that others can follow, and it works best as a witness. Because if you're a witness and you just start and I just know it all, then you're not setting the example that you want others to follow, which is to do as Kirk and Dee have done, and so many others that are essential to getting this message out, which is to do their own due diligence, to also explore and learn, because if you follow that example, rather than believe that guy, you now trust Yahowah.
Yes.
So God wants his witness to learn and grow. And if you're learning and growing, it means that the stuff you know tomorrow is greater than the stuff you know today. And sometimes the things you learn tomorrow are a little different than the things you knew yesterday. Sometimes it's just more complete. Yeah. So, you know, it took a while to fully process what follows. But now, if I may restate the assessment presented at the conclusion of our reviews of Yahweh's prophetic pronouncements to Dowd, I think we'll see what follows more clearly. Dowd exemplifies and represents more than one man. He represents Israel. He represents himself, the one man that God chose. He represents Yahud, the beloved of Yah, who gave his life for his people in his second life. And he represents all Yisrael as the king of Yisrael on his return. He also embodies the best and worst in Yisrael. There's so many things that he got wrong. Nothing that he got wrong when he was writing a Mizmowr, but the things that he got wrong in his life. And in that way, he is Israel. So more than Jacob, Dowd is Israel. The promises made to him were made to them. From being the children of God, what does he call them? Bnei Yisrael, the children of Yisrael. Mm-hmm. In fact, he even tells Pharaoh that Yisrael is my firstborn. And he announces to the world in this 89th Mizmowr that Dowd is my firstborn. Common denominator, right? Means Dowd.
Yeah.
If Israel is firstborn, if firstborn is Dowd, Dowd is Israel. So the promises that were made to him were made to them. Not only being the children of God, but being heirs to the covenant, to being recipients of the land. His joys and heartaches, his ongoing battles with Goyim, his insights and confusion, the benefits he enjoyed in concert with the covenant, and the consequences he endured when he ran afoul of it, are all shared by the nation he shepherded and that he saved. It was in concert with Dowd representing Yisrael and of Yisrael's contribution to annulling the truths we have been considering throughout this series on the 89th Mizmowr, that these words were prophetically inscribed in parallel to 2 Samuel 7. After all, it is Yisrael which has, but now you yourselves have refused to accept, creating a foul stench by snubbing, such that you have rejected by diminishing the merit of, even spurning over time by repudiating the very essence of, improperly and on your own initiative meddling, while presumptively passing over your Messiah. Oh my God, is that hit Israel right between the eyes. You know, today the non-Orthodox refer to the Haredim as Messianics. They're saying, oh, we can't be Israel until the Messiah arrives. We can't do this, can't do that, can't do anything, can't even defend the land until Messiah arrives. And they got no idea who he is. They've snubbed the actual Messiah. They repudiated him. They never once say, until Dowd returns. They've rejected and diminished the merit and spurned, repudiating the essence of their Messiah. Mm-hmm. Mashyach. It is why Judaism exists. What was the first act of Judaism when Rabbi Akiva, the father of rabbinic Judaism, burst onto the scene? What was his act to prove that he was the guy? A false Messiah. Not only a false Messiah, one named Son of a Star. And what did the nation of Israel do? They took Bar Kokhba's star and applied it to themselves, and even took the false Messiah's symbol and slathered it over Dowd. There's no Star of David. It's reprehensible. It's a sign of being Stockholm, taking the symbol that was used to bring the Rome upon you, to cause the diaspora.
Right.
That was the symbol that separated Jews so they would endure the horror of the Holocaust. And you made that symbol the symbol of your religion and of your nation. What in the hell were you thinking? It's kind of like Christians saying, oh, well, this Jesus Christ, he's God, so our symbol is going to be a dead God on a stick. What are you thinking?
Yeah.
You have to be stupid to be religious?
Yes.
You know, you read this, and if you weren't as verbose as I am, you'd be speechless. I mean, that's the natural reaction to this. God just nailed Judaism. And not only did he nail Judaism, of course, the most popular religion in the world was started by Jews. And it does this very thing. This is the essence of Christians' replacement theology upon which the religion is predicated. So Yahweh's phrasing, his timing are impeccable. But he inspired this 3,000 years ago. Why did it take 3,000 years to make sense of it? to draw your attention to it. And now that you're hearing it, what are you going to do about it? The Creator God of the universe affirmed this profound truth so many times and ways, it is befuddling that as few as one in a million Yehudim will come to acknowledge Dowd, or that 5 billion Goyim bequeath the Greek variation of this title on another. After enduring 2,000 years of harassment for failing to accept Jesus as their Christ, it turns out Jews were right. Well, halfway. Now it's time to take the next step and recognize HaMashiach for who he truly is, so that the family can be reconciled. If you are a descendant of Jacob or Dowd, reflect upon what God inspired in Mizmowr 89:38. Almost everything religious and secular Jews have claimed regarding Dowd David, their anticipated Messiah, and the fulfillment of the Moedim is false, upended, incongruent. Jews have, on average, 15 points higher IQ than the rest of the world. But you couldn't figure this out. Before it's too late, get with the program. Embrace what Dowd represents, and then accept the realization that he is not only HaMashiach, but also Ben Elohim, the Son of God, who served as the Pesach El, which is why God refers to him as the Zeruah, sacrificial lamb. Do not pass over him in an ill-conceived attempt to validate the lies of Judaism or to justify the myths of Christianity. Now, I understand that Yehudim have been plagued over the years, actually the centuries, by those who believe that Jesus Christ was the Messiah. And because Christians blame Jews for killing their mythical misnomer, the very idea of the Messiah being the Son of God and of him fulfilling Pesach has to be disorienting.
Sure.
And while there never was any rationale or reason for a Messiah named Jesus Christ, no validity to the religion of Christianity, no justification for the New Testament, or credibility in calling oneself a Christian, there has been incalculable harm perpetrated by these delusions. And while that may have been the most heroic and anti-Semitic fraud ever perpetrated, the truth is sweet revenge. The Messiah was here. And he was the Son of God. He not only fulfilled Pesach and Matzah, leading to Bikurim and Shavuah, one does not have to change his name or upend his identity or deny any prophecy to accept any one of the many hundreds of promises to this moment in time. I love it when you come upon something that is the grand unification theory, is what Einstein sought. You know, he tried to get all of the five forces to act like they were one thing, like he was able to do with energy and matter. Well, Dowd is the grand unification theory, except it's not a theory, it's fact.
Right.
He exemplifies the covenant. He enabled the covenant. He exemplifies the Torah. He fulfilled the Torah. He is the Son of God. He was the firstborn. He is the one who fulfilled firstborn children. God told Abraham when they had that whole conversation about father and son, who's going to provide the lamb, and then Yahweh said, I will. And he offered his son. It is the one unifying theme that makes sense of all of it, of Pesach opening the doorway to the family home. Dowd's name, Kirk, has three letters. What are the letters on the bookends, the first and the third letter?
The Dalet.
What is a Dalet? A doorway.
It's a doorway to the home,
yep.
Family home.
Right.
Yep.
In the middle of that is the tent peg that in those days held the tent. It was the pillar in the middle of the tent. It would hold the tent up.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So you have Dowd opening the doorway to life in the covenant. And then so that we were prepared to meet with God, he does the most magnificent thing in the history of humanity. He agrees to take all of our guilt, everything we'd ever done wrong, and take it into Sheol, the place totally separated from Yahweh, and deposit it there, never to be seen again. What a perfect way to resolve the problem of our guilt. It's gone.
Yeah.
We look perfect because there is no evidence against us.
No evidence, no trial.
No trial, no evidence.
No appearance.
We look perfect. Everything we do, God says, hey, that's pretty cool. And everything we screw up, I doesn't even see it. It's the best solution ever. And what does it lead to? It leads to the Bakor, firstborn, fulfilling Bakurim.
Mm-hmm.
The plural of that, firstborn children. And thereby enabling the benefits of the covenant. It's the grand unification theory. It brings everything together. There's no gaps. There's no contradictions. There's no, but what about this? Now you don't have to worry about why there's no reference anywhere to the fulfillment of Pesach and Matzah and Bakurim, other than that which speaks of Dowd or was written in first person by Dowd. You don't have to wonder why no one else's name is ever associated with the returning Mashyach and King of Kings other than Dowd. You don't have to worry about, well, every magnificent prophecy either has Dowd's name in it or makes it obvious that the prophet is speaking of Dowd. Now you understand when God says, okay, I'll never speak directly to you again. I got this all figured out. I'm going to choose this guy. He's my chosen one. He's going to do it. And he's not going to just do the talk. He's going to do the walk. Everything fits together and makes perfect sense when we see it from that point of view. Perhaps worse than removing Yahweh's name 7,000 times from his testimony in the Torah Nabiwa Mizmor and replacing it with the adversary's title, the Lord. This error in judgment, this lapse of character, by denying the Messiah, has caused more harm to Yehudim, Jews, than any other. They ought not to have been looking to the future for a Messiah to save them, when he'd already been the most prominent and productive man in their past and has already saved them.
Yes.
Dowd's name would not have been changed to Jesus Christ, and Christianity's New Testament would have been stillborn, had the actual identity of Yahweh's Messiah been acknowledged by his people.
Yep.
And that it has been conveyed by Yahweh. Let's affirm a heartbreaking reality. Jews have been their own worst enemy. Look even at Dowd's name. They call it David. Dowd has meaning. Look up Dowd. It means beloved.
Mm-hmm.
David doesn't have any meaning. And by changing the pronunciation of the wa, which conveys the O sound in Yahweh's name, to a V, is
it doesn't exist.
Yeah, evidence against Israel that they were deliberately trying to keep people, their own people even, from being able to pronounce Yahweh's name, to keep God out of their lives and out of their religion. The Hitpael stem was used to modify a bar by improperly and on your own initiative meddling where presumptively passing over. So to have the Hitpael stem modify this concept proves this case. Hitpael means without any outside influence, you did this.
You
did it. You're guilty. This uncommon stem reveals that the religious have unjustifiably passed right by him in antipathy, somehow displeased with his affairs, all while acting on their own initiative, and thus not God's. Equally telling, a bar is the basis of Pesach, and thus Passover. When Yahweh defines Pesach, the verb he uses is a bar. And so what has he done here? He says that they have failed to recognize this connection of a bar to Passover with their Messiah, equating the rejection of the Messiah with foregoing the purpose of the Mikra of Pesach. On behalf of Yehudah and Yisrael, even the Goyim who were listening, accept and embrace the beloved Mashyach, the Melech. Accept him as your brother and as God's son, even as your shepherd, but mostly as your savior. Listen to Yahweh's Bakar, chosen one, the Kodesh, set apart one of Yisrael, and concur with him. Because when it comes to God, Dowd is right. He is Sadak. As for religious Jews, it's a perplexing irony, really. Wearing black and bobbing their heads up and down as if to exorcise their demons, they babble to their nameless G-D and minions, facing a stone wall erected by a ruthless dictator, while reciting Dowd's Mizmowr from rote. Only they would consider what he had to say instead. If only their heads were not as hard as the Edomites' wall, some of what they recite might actually penetrate their thick skulls. But alas, it is not to be. Dowd's Mizmowr and Yahweh's Dabar are for the non-religious. And it wouldn't take long for Yehudim to hit rock bottom. The fall from Dowd was swift and it was painful. It begun with Solomon. He capitulated to accommodate the religious interests of his wives and concubines, reminding Yisrael of their fall and of the religions they begot and those they beguiled. Yahweh declares, you have repudiated and renounced the covenant with your coworker. You have dishonored and defiled his dedication to the land. When Dowd is renounced, so are the Moedim, because he fulfilled them. When Dowd is repudiated, so is the covenant, because he enabled it. When Dowd is dishonored, the land to which he was devoted suffers.
Wow.
So what I don't understand, and I don't think Yah does either, is with the conditions of his covenant so liberating, uplifting, and with the benefits so enriching and empowering, and with him proving that his promises are reliable, why disavow and replace what God is offering? With Dowd so generous, why disavow what he has accomplished and reject what he is offering? Makes no sense. For those who may be protesting, saying that they haven't repudiated Dowd because they honor David by having chosen to fly a flag emblazoned with his star.
I
challenge that assumption by categorically stating that there has never been a star of David, and David isn't his name. Creating a false caricature of a man in this manner degrades his authentic nature, and it plays you for a fool.
Mm-hmm.
The history of the development of that star is just tragic. From Bar Kokhba, son of a star, to its origins then again in the Zohar, to how it was plucked out of obscurity, and largely because of how Bar Kokhba, the false messiah, led to the diaspora and to the degradation of Jews in Europe. That star followed them. That star was the symbol of their greatest mistake. And now Stockholmed, they wear it. They wave it. They adorn their Talmuds and their kippahs with it. A little explanation may be helpful as we consider the next statement. The sheepfold, whose walls have been torn down, represents the barriers around the covenant, which were designed to keep the religious, political, conspiratorial, and ignorant out. You have broken down and destroyed his entire sheepfold and all of its walls. You have caused the undoing, the degradation and destruction of his fortifications. As a rebuke to every religion, Yahowah has deliberately restricted access to his covenant, effectively keeping the religious and political out. In the first condition of the covenant is walk away from Babel, which is the wellspring from which the intermixing of religion and politics was first manifest. Ignorant or adverse to the five instructional terms God set as his conditions for entry, men like Akiba and Paul have sought to annul the Almighty's intent while projecting their own. So let's be blunt. The Garden of Eden had walls. Why do you think the Garden of Eden has walls? And what's the connection between the walls that were torn down of his fortifications, of his sheepfold, and the very walls of Eden? The walls of Eden weren't to keep Adam and Chawa locked inside as if they were prisoners, but instead it was to keep the rest of humankind out because they were religious, they were vicious, and they did not belong. The gone, protective garden enclosure of Eden, great joy, was as the name implies. It was fun because the curmudgeons were excluded. And it was Eden, so will be Shamaim. As was God's relationship with Dowd, so will it be with all of the covenant's children. That is why this Mizmowr psalm is so important. Dowd and the covenant continue to be integrated. They are indistinguishable and inseparable. With the beloved upholding and representing the family, such that an attack on Dowd is an assault against Israel.
What is a revelation?
Wow. All who pass by this way plunder him. They ransack him. They loot him. They rob him. That's the very basis of Judaism and Christianity, is to plunder and rob Dowd as the Messiah, the Son of God, and Savior. That is the essence of those religions. And here is God telling us in the 89th Mizmowr that all who pass this way, consider that the Abrahamic religions, all plunder him. He has become scorned and abusively ridiculed, defied and upbraided, insulted and held in contempt. He's dead and buried, according to both Peter and Paul. By those who claim some affinity with him. Christians, Muslims, Jews. Claiming to have an affinity with David is common. His name appears in the New Testament, in the Talmud, and in the Quran. Similarly, Christians, Jews, and Muslims with wholly contradictory belief systems all claim to be Abrahamic religions, even though they degrade Abraham's legacy. Alleging similar origins, their gods share nothing in common. Christians are particularly guilty, lugging around an Old Testament with its tribute to Dowd around with their revised ones, which plunders his legacy.
Easy.
They claim an affinity for the boy who slew the giant and who sang the 23rd Psalm, not knowing that it is Yahowah, for whose name's sake the song was written. I stumbled into something the other day.
Mm-hmm.
You know that when the great Isaiah scroll was found, it was found by three shepherd boys looking for lost sheep. There are three Zoroa. They found the container in which the great Isaiah scroll was in because they threw a stone into a dark place.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed. There are some very, very interesting parallels between shepherds and lost sheep and throwing stones.
That's
then,
cool.
Of course, in that they blame Jews for all of their problems, they must deny that he was the most Yehud of all men. Even in the Quran, there's an entire surah devoted to Dawood. Well, the problem is that this imposter was a Muslim. He worshipped Allah. Confronted with the Dead Sea Scrolls and the parchments memorializing this psalm 1,000 years before their religion was invented, I wonder how a literate Muslim would react after seeing Yahweh's name rather than Allah's. Many of those who passed this way ransack the covenant, ridiculing everything that Dowd represents by taking it from him and giving it to themselves or others. They jeopardize countless lives by falsely claiming an affinity with either Dowd or the covenant, and then advocating on behalf of their New Testament, their Talmud, or their Quran. And sadly, many of them have settled in proximity to Israel. Today we know them as the practitioners of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Speaking of the religious, who, whether they be pilgrims or refugees, crusaders or jihadists, God says, speaking to his people, you have lifted up and exalted the upper hand of his foes and his adversaries, especially those who try to constrain and limit him, Sar. You have caused all of those who demonstrate animosity and rancor toward him to be delighted. This is, God is making the accusation that I've been making for the past year or so. Yeah, you just beat me to it by 3,000 years, but give him credit, he's a lot smarter than I am. Yeah, he's a lot smarter than I am. But nonetheless, I did come to this conclusion before I had figured this statement out, so at least I'm, you know, smart enough to figure it out. Slow, but got there. Judaism, in its present form, emerged under Rabbi Akiba to deal with the upstart religion that was being promoted by Peter and Paul of this false Messiah and false Son of God who had done something that they don't quite understand on Passover. And to refute its and rebut its growing popularity, Judaism was created. And rather than saying, wait a minute, you got this all wrong, it's Dowd that's the Messiah. It's Dowd that was predicted to arrive in Jerusalem on this day to fulfill Pesach and Matzah and then Bikurim. It's Dowd who is the Son of God. It's Dowd who is our Savior. It's Dowd who is our King. It's Dowd who is returning. Rather than say those things and to cite the hundreds of prophecies that Yahowah made to affirm them, they instead went the opposite direction and said, well, you got a false Messiah, we got one too. You like the term rabbi, I think we like it too. We're going to take that term from you. And by doing so, by trying to rebut a lie with another lie, what God says is that you, my people, have lifted up and exalted the upper hand of Dowd's primary foes, of the most popular religion in the world that robbed Dowd of everything to create this myth of a Christian God. You did this. You're responsible. And he, by the way, he could have said the same thing about Islam. If it wasn't for Jews selling Muhammad Talmud stories and Yathrib, the Quran would never have existed. Islam would never have existed. There would be no Fakistinians as terrorists trying to kill Jews today. They've got yeast all over their faces. You've caused all of those who demonstrate animosity and rancor toward him to be delighted. God has made his point. He, as you'd expect of any loving father, is angry. He's annoyed by what those who falsely claim to speak for him have done to denigrate his son and to diminish all that he accomplished through him. It was the Jews who gave the upper hand to those who would seek to destroy them. No, the Jews didn't kill the Christian God. No, what they did was suicidal. They drove a stake to their own heart by denying the actual Messiah and Son of God and his fulfillment of Pesach, Matzah, and Bikurim. They destroyed themselves. They killed themselves. The four most toxic belief systems were all founded and abetted by Jews: Judaism, Christianity, Islam, and socialism. By their failure to acknowledge that Dowd was the Messiah and Son of God, and that he returned to fulfill Pesach, Matzah, and Bukkotim as predicted, Yehudim opened the door for Christianity through their denials. Great lie of replacement theology. And they were also guilty of creating their own replacement theology. They replaced Yahweh's name with Hashem and Adonai. They replaced the Torah with the Talmud. They replaced a Messiah that was exceedingly well known with an unknown Messiah. Yes, they too have replacement theology. For Christianity to differentiate itself from Yahowah and Dowd, from their Torah and covenant, enough to become popular with Greeks and Romans, they would need a New Testament. And for it to be believable, it would have to borrow heavily upon Yahweh's testimony, claiming its prophecies as their own. Therefore, the new religion proposed that it was authorized by the same God and justified by the same prophecies. But how is that possible when one outcome is so contradictory to the other? The answer for Christianity became replacement theology. This sleight of hand wasn't simply about assigning the blessings and promises God offered for Jews to Gentiles without any justification, that God was going to choose to work with the people who sought the eradication of his family and his children. It's about replacing one covenant with another, and then Yahweh and Dowd with Jesus. If you don't concur, do what I've done. After scrutinizing Paul's renunciation of Dowd for the sake of his Jesus, go to any Christian site and read their assessment of every prophecy pertaining to David. You'll find that Jesus isn't named in a single prophecy, but every time Dowd's name appears, Christians insist that it actually applies to their Christ, as if God doesn't know the difference between the two names, nor is he aware of which one he anointed his Mashiach. Yes, Christianity requires a very stupid God and irrational faithful. The problem for Christians was as simple as it was profound and remains profound. Without the Torah, prophets, and Psalms, they have no God and they have no credibility. But with them, they represent a jumble of contradictions. Their only hope was for the people to believe their lies and for the faith to occlude judgment. They banked on apathy and ignorance. For the most part, they got it.
Yeah.
And yet today, at least for some, there is a battle for hearts and souls, and it is raging throughout the world. A struggle between right and wrong. The loudest voices are those who claim that they worship religious gods, while the chorus of those who stand with Dowd and speak for Yahowah is currently faint among the billions. We're about to end our broadcast portion of our program. We'll go through this next statement as we continue to record, since the overwhelming preponderance of people listen to the archives of this program as it's posted around the ether of the internet.
Okay.
So what's worse? And adding to the resentment, you have turned around again, having assaulted, besieged, bound up, and constrained the rocky crag of this battle for Choreb, such that you do not stand with him or support him in this conflict. God's very clever when he inspires someone to convey his testimony. And sometimes he can say, okay, we've been speaking of Dowd, and they're they've done all these things pursuant to him. But he can also throw in a word which which trips the believers up. So they're not likely to understand. And Choreb is one of those words. It actually both Choreb and Shur.
Mm-hmm.
Shur is a rocky crag. That's the basis of my name, by the way.
Yes.
And just as Yehudim have shown their resentment towards and have besieged and bound up and constrained their appreciation of Dowd, they
mm-hmm.
do the same to the rocky crag. What is the battle mm-hmm. for Choreb? Choreb is where the Torah was revealed.
Sure.
That's
yeah.
this
mm-hmm.
battleground. And the majority of Yah's people do not stand with him or support him in this conflict. That's Mizmowr, Psalm 89:43. There's a plethora of tantalizing insights in this little statement, beginning with the realization that Amp's primary connection is to engender resentment and wrath. It's heavy breathing, frustration.
Mm-hmm.
And those who continue to turn against Dowd will endure the sting of this judgment. Mm. God's not happy. That's what Amp conveys. Also interesting is Shur. It's translated as the edge in the Jewish Publication Society's Holy Scriptures according to the Masoretic text. It is scribed as a verb. There was no definite article in the text, and edge is not among Shur's meanings when presented as a noun. Had it been written as a noun, our options would have been rocky crag, sharp flint, or stone.
Mm-hmm.
But it was written in the Qowl infinitive, which means it's definitely a verb. And it is not only active, but also intensifies the actual and ongoing action of laying siege, of enclosing, binding up, and confining in a hostile and harassing fashion. You know that Sur is the word that sits in the midst of the time of Jacob's Sur, troubles. It's the basis of Mitzrayim. Mitz is my, so to question the implications of Sur, and the M makes it just plural, of being besieged, of being in a crucible of religious and political oppression. Sur is a really important term. Shar and Sur.
Mm-hmm.
Laying siege, enclosing, binding, confining. This makes perfect sense because the perspective, or the perpetrators, I should say, engendering Dowd's wrath continue to be the Jewish religious leaders who have sought to constrain the Savior by assaulting his achievements. You won't find a rabbi speaking of Dowd's sacrifice and his enduring love by laying down his life to provide life to Yisrael through Pesach. They don't even celebrate matzah anymore. And yet, the greatest gift that the Son gave us was to take our guilt and haul it off into Sheol. They won't acknowledge
here, here.
That. There yeah. is no connection between Dowd and firstborn because, well, according to Judaism, they're different species. God and G-D and David. And they're not smart enough to recognize Dowd is the embodiment of the covenant and the covenant is God's family. Figure it out. It's not hard. It's a simple story. I am his father. He is my son. He is the exemplar of the Bereth covenant. Further, if we are to read rocky crag or stone into this depiction, it was based upon this sharp rocky edifice that Yahweh first revealed his fiery light to Moshe. And then to the children of Yisrael upon Mount Choreb. where he would also reveal his Torah. Moreover, it is my contention that Dowd's song, the 89th Mizmowr, is the cornerstone of the covenant home, of Yahweh's home, and that it was revealed in the Yobel year of 3000 Yah, 968 BCE, 4 years into Solomon's reign as the construction began on Yahweh's home. The Hebrew name for the mountain upon which Yahweh introduced himself to Moshe and then revealed the Torah is Choreb. Spelled the same way in the text, it also serves as the Hebrew word for dry and desolate, battle and conflict, sword and chisel. And while we can choose any definition that works within this context, we are prudent to include each that fits so as not to deprive the reader of God's full intent. In this case, I see Dowd standing between the two mountains of God, Choreb and Moriah, bringing the Torah to the heart of the land and fulfilling it in the city of Dowd. This is not only evident by the king's marvelous dissertation on the Torah in the 119th Mizmowr, but also by his volunteering to serve as the Pesach Gael, Passover Lamb. There is a battle that is being waged for the souls of humankind. The religious are on one side and the Father and Son are on the other. And while Judaism and Christianity have written Yahweh and Dowd, Choreb and Moriah, the Torah and the Mikre out of their story, Father and Son are battling to bring them back to Yisrael's attention. There has been a war of words for the past 3,000 years, to Dowd or not to Dowd. It is the ultimate question, because where we stand with Dowd characterizes where we stand with God. This war has often erupted in bloody conflict. The two Assyrian and Babylonian conquests, the two Roman wars against the tiny province of Yehudah, Judea, the abuse Jews have suffered under the Roman Catholics during the Crusades, and under the Ottomans, by the whole of Europe, by the Nazis and Soviets, and today by Islamic jihadists and progressives, serve as proof that the world is against Dowd and the people he represents. Yep. This may be a good place to stop. The next statement is 89:44. It is it's both profound and heartbreaking. I'll share it this evening because it is heartbreaking, and maybe I can go over it a little quicker next week, because it's hard to start on something that is sad, but it is.
Sure.
With the exception of those who have come to know Yahweh and his beloved Son, many through these books, what follows remains true of almost everyone else. You have truncated, causing a succession to all of the work, removing and taking away from his purifying brilliance and means to restore with his glorious status. And his position of honor, his dignity and power, you have hurled to the ground. Mizmowr lyrics to sing, 89:44. In their own lives, they have truncated what Dowd has done by fulfilling Pesach, Matzah, and Bukurim, as well as Shabuah.
Mm-hmm.
They've caused a cessation to all of the work. The writing of these psalms to explain what he was going to do and then his actual fulfillment. They committed suicide. And they've taken away from the most brilliant man who ever lived. The one man who gave it all to restore their relationship with Yahowah. His ultimate position of honor and dignity and power, the greatest of all time, they've hurled to the ground. Yahowah is building a throne room in his home for Dowd. In this very Mizmowr we read where Yahowah says that Dowd is Elyon, as Almighty God. He's coming back so empowered and so brilliant, he's going to appear as if the sun in God's presence. God honored him by calling him the one thing that is more important than anything else. He is my son. I am his father. That's as good as it gets. All the rest is fluff compared to that. He was the Zeruah, the Passover lamb. He fulfilled matzah. What more can a man do to earn your respect? And you've thrown it into the dirt. Why does Zechariah 12 say there's going to be so much shrieking and moaning and crying when Dowd appears and they realize this is the guy that fulfilled Passover? We've hurled it all to the ground. Clearly, God is annoyed. He is disgusted that his beloved son that he anointed and his Mashyach, the shepherd he chose to establish his covenant family, and the sacrificial lamb who opened heaven's door, has been so universally discounted by religious Jews. They have done to Dowd what they have done to the Shabat, renouncing both and reducing both from a celebration of the covenant relationship to doing nothing. And in this case, by either failing to read the words Yahowah inspired in Dowd's song or failing to act upon them, religious Jews brought untold misery upon God's people. The failure of rabbis to recognize and capitalize upon what Dowd represents and has accomplished is the fulcrum upon which the Jewish people have descended, when this should have been the moment they ascended. They were given the opportunity to restore their relationship with Yahowah and to come clean by accepting Dowd's fulfillment of Chag Matzah. They would have been welcomed back into the covenant by embracing Dowd's glorious status as the chosen Messiah and the glorious Lamb. But the rabbis not only forewent all of this, they tossed it all away, hurling Dowd's dignity to the ground. Well, that probably is a good place to start. It has us thinking, God's people thinking, saying, you know, we are, as Jews, we are responsible for all that. We might as well own it. But starting with me, with one person, we can make a difference. 22 years ago on Towrah, I was one and I was raw, and there was none other. And now, 22 years
long way, baby.
Look where we are. Look what we've learned.
Yeah.
You know, thousands of insights that are unheralded.
Yeah.
30 volumes of beautifully presented testimony from Yahowah and through his prophets that we can capitalize on and relate to. Grow from, be restored into fellowship. Yeah, here we are. Are you listening? Take advantage. come clean. Accept the gift. Acknowledge Yahowah. Embrace Dowd. Accept the invitations to meet with Yahowah. Embrace the conditions of the covenant. It's all there for the taking. And the benefits are forever. Well, I want to, again, thank you all for listening. This is a truly mentally stimulating and emotional experience.
Yes.
Sharing this Mizmowr with you, because it is our lives. It is what we represent, is what we live for. It is the hope for Yisrael. It is the truth summarized. It's the answer to every important question. This is the cornerstone upon which everything else is built. So once one comes to embrace it, you have unification. You see how all the pieces fit together. And once you come to see how the Mizmowr conveyed Dowd's involvement in the fulfilling the Mikre, and how the Mikre enabled the covenant's benefits, and how they all bring us into Yahweh's family. And you see how all of this is related and connected. Then you have the greatest gift of all, which is understanding. And with that understanding, the door is flung wide open for you to enter God's home and be part of his family. So with that, we'll say happy Shabbat. Welcome, particularly to those now listening in Yisrael. You are on the cusp of the greatest journey, the greatest reward in universal history. And to think that you are there now in God's home, where he is going to return in 10 years, and you're going to be been invited now to be one of those people, and you cannot just be one of them, you can be a catalyst. For encouraging more Yisraelites to accept Yahowah and Dowd and the Torah.
Bring seven.
Yes, and everything the covenant and the Mikre represent. There's no better time to be you, to be there. So for all of you, for each of those faces that I see now with every word that I share in this program or that I write, this is your time. This is your opportunity. Seize it. You know, even if you have your fellow countrymen, not if, you will, have them rebuke you and turn against you, it's one thing to be rebuked for your own mistakes, but it's a source of pride, a great blessing to be challenged for making Yahweh's testimony known to his people. And you've got 10 years. And that's all you have to make a difference. And then we enjoy forever. But if you can make a difference, forever will be better because of what you've done to encourage more Yisraelites to reach up and become part of this family reunion. So capitalize on the time you have left. You are the people that Yahowah has been inviting, that he's reaching out to you to at this time. There's no one on the planet more important. Please listen, grow, learn. Go where the words lead. Embrace the truth. And once you're sufficiently well-read and you've made the connections and gone from to the point where you know what's true and you've made the connections so you understand who God is and who Dowd is and what they are offering, then share it. Be confident and bold. Live it. Laugh in the face of adversity. Be joyful as you present what God is offering. And be uncompromising. So with that, I wish you all a happy Shabbat to one and all, and a wonderful week. We look forward to being back with you this time next week. Tonight was a program without news. I think we covered a lot of ground because of it. The news we revealed tonight is that Yahweh is returning with Dowd, and Father and Son are offering you the greatest gift in the history of the universe. Come to know it and embrace it. May Yah bless you all. Good night.
Good night, y'all. Good night, Dee.
Good night. Good night, Kirk.